Yo, what's up guys? Old School Dan here, and in this video, I'm going to talk about how to get classic physique symmetry. But there's different parts in this video, so I don't want you to mistake this video for the ideal classic proportions, like your calves have to match your biceps with your neck as well. That's not what this is about. This is about developing that X-frame physique like Frank Zane, the classic proportions and symmetry, the lines. But anyways, there's a couple parts to this video. First, I'm going to talk about what symmetry is. Then, I'm going to talk about some examples of guys who have great symmetry. Then, I'm going to talk about why you should achieve symmetry and what will happen if you don't. And then, lastly, would be how to achieve classic physique symmetry. All right, so with that being said, let us get started. All right, so what is symmetry? Symmetry is could be identified as the X physique, which is the broad shoulders, the small waist, the flaring, the big calves, I mean the wide lats, and the forearms. Those are what Larry Scott calls the peripheral muscles. So it's a physique that is very proportional, hard, and muscular. It is the type of physique that the Webster Dictionary states delights the senses and exalts the mind. Damn, that's some powerful ass shit. Let me say that again. It's fun. Delights the senses and exalts the mind. Damn. It is a physique that is very aesthetically pleasing to the eye. Kind of like when Steve Reeves was walking down the beach and he had crowds of people just following him just because they wanted to take a glance at his just amazing, symmetrical, proportional, Greek-like body. All right, so I think I've given a pretty clear description, definition of what symmetry is. Now, let me give you some examples of guys who have great symmetry. All right, so we got two examples of guys who have amazing symmetry. Number one, Steve Reeves. He will always be in the book of amazing proportion, symmetry, aesthetics, the king of aesthetics, classic. I mean, this guy's legendary. You can see by his physique, big calves, the sweeping thighs, the wide shoulders, the wide lats. The square chest, the big forearms. And then we got Francis Benefato, classic guy. I mean, Bob Paris is pretty good too, but this guy is really good. Francis Benefato, the wide shoulders, square chest, the small waist, the sweeping thighs, the big calves. You know what? I like Francis Benefato compared to Frank Zane. He's got a little bit more mass, and I think that's what's really cool about him because he's still got that Frank Zane look, but he's got the mass with it. All right, so those were some really good examples of symmetry. Now, let us get started on why symmetry is so important. All right, so even someone with an untrained eye and with no prior knowledge of bodybuilding can go to his first physique contest and notice immediately that someone's body looks more right and beautiful than others. Why? That is due to shape and symmetry. When you have a symmetrical and proportional body, people will instantly recognize that. I remember this one time I was on the set of Stanley Wexler and I was wearing like a bunch of sweaters and shit like that. And then once all that came off and I put on a tank top and some shorts, people just couldn't stop staring at me. Like it was just like I was like just some kind of a bright light in the darkness. It was just kind of crazy. Another reason why symmetry is an advantage is because you can also get women with it. Women like a symmetrical looking guy. They don't like a guy with like tiny ass legs and a big ass upper body. Like it looks weird. Like they like a guy with like a nice developed like calf, legs, nice biceps, nice chest, good back. So another reason to have symmetry is that it wins contests. Frank Zane was able to beat Arnold at the Olympia because of his symmetry. Then again, Arnold suffered another loss to, it might have been Chet Yordan. Because I know Arnold lost a contest because of his calves. It might have been a Miss Universe, but it was due to symmetry again. You see, people with symmetry don't have lagging muscles. That is because they understand the importance of shape and symmetry. Why do you think when people look at Frank Zane, they're like, "Oh, that guy, he had the perfect body." Because this guy had insane symmetry. The big calves, the wide lats, the vacuum, the small waist, the broad shoulders. Look at the silhouette. It's the silhouette, the X physique. What I've also been reading is that a symmetrical body is less prone to injury as well. All right, so we talked about why symmetry is so important. Now let's talk about what happens if you don't try to achieve a symmetrical and proportional body. All right, here we have two examples of bodybuilders who do not look right, even when they are in hard muscular condition. We have Benny Potta and Tim Belknap. Now, I mean no disrespect at all when I say this, but both of them lack a V-taper. They're too thick, they're blocky, and they're shapeless. Now, they get by on their incredible mass and muscularity, and they have fantastic individual parts, but the overall package is missing. But, of course, many will argue that shape is entirely due to genetics. And if you do not possess the wide shoulders and small waist of Steve Reeves, there is nothing that can be done about it. But if we know one thing for sure, is that the person with the X physique will always win more shows. Anybody who has ever won a Mr. Olympia had great symmetry. Lita Brada, Frank Zane, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Steve Reeves, they all had something in common. Great symmetry. That is exactly why they win shows. See, sometimes I get frustrated. Like, I don't like when people just think bodybuilding is all about just size. You really have to think about it. Bodybuilding started from wanting to create a shapely, symmetrical, proportional, beautiful body. That is exactly where the foundation came from. I don't know. It's been completely destroyed today. It's overly done. They're all mass produced, like Frank Zane. It's like an assembly line. They're done quick within a year or two. This sport started off with trying to achieve what Leonardo da Vinci called it's not the X physique, but you ever seen that man where it's like he has his arms down and then his arms out, so it looks like he's like an X? Kind of like it was like the picture I showed you at the beginning. But that is what they strive for the ideal physique. Proportional, symmetrical, beautiful. All right, so now we're going to talk about how to build a symmetrical physique. All right, so tip number one. This is the most important tip you want to keep in mind. Now, this is some advice that Larry Scott gave to Frank Zane. I know I made another video about this, but anyways, it is called, the other video is called Frank Zane Tips on Symmetry and the Illusion. But anyways, the tip is, if you really want to achieve what they call symmetry, Larry Scott says, work the peripheral muscles, which is the lat spread, the small waist, the shoulders, the calves, the forearms. All right, so that was one of the biggest tips that Larry Scott gave to Frank Zane. Now, I'm going to give you a couple more tips on how to achieve symmetry regardless of your genetics. Number one, always emphasize your slowest growing and or least developed muscles in your training more than your fastest growing and or best developed muscles. Give your weak points priority in your workouts. Train them first when your energy, strength, and enthusiasm is at the highest. Do more total sets and exercises for your weak points as well in order to create symmetry and improve proportions. Sometimes it might be necessary to hold back gains in some faster growing overdeveloped muscles to catch up. Now, see, the thing is, my quads, I got big legs. For a skinny guy, I got big legs. A lot of people tell me, like, I even through my sweats, people tell me, look, man, you got big legs, man. And I'm like, I know. Back then when I used to squat, and I was doing like front squats and I was doing back squats, man, my quads were fucking huge. I swear, they were really, really big. They looked like turnip thighs. I had massive quads. But I have slow developing calves. So I had like a mushroom leg. Like big quads, but tiny ass calves. So here's what I did to fix that. I had to start training my calves first at the beginning of my workouts, and I had to cut back on some leg training. All right, so that was tip number one. Now let's move on to tip two. Do not train all muscle groups equally hard or with the same number of sets. This is correlate of rule number one. Do more work for the weak muscles, less for the strong ones. Remember, not all muscles respond equally to training, and not all exercises are equal in terms of promoting muscle growth. For instance, bench presses build lower and middle pecs too well for some people, leaving the smaller and less developed upper pecs to fend for themselves. As much as we would like them to, incline presses and incline flies do not build upper pecs as well as bench presses develop the middle and lower pecs. Obviously, then it will be necessary to do more sets and harder work to create an equal amount of growth in the upper pecs. All right, see, let me give you an example. I had a problem with my chest. I had a lot of mass in it, but I had no upper chest. I had to mostly start doing just incline presses. I've been doing incline presses for like the longest time. Like, I do more incline presses this year than I've ever done in my whole entire life. Like, I rarely do the bench press and I rarely do the flat dumbbell press. The reason why is that my chest, my middle chest, grows so damn well my upper pecs can't keep up with it. So I had to switch it around and put the weak muscles first and train them harder and train the more dominant muscles like not as hard and not with as many sets either. Never try to develop all muscles equally or to build all muscles to their maximum size potential. Some muscles grow too fast and easily, especially the lower pecs, the front delts, the upper thighs, the hips, the glutes, the traps. On the other hand, you should be working the smaller muscle groups like the calves, the abs, the serratus, the intercostals, the side and rear deltoids, forearms, lower biceps, lateral head of triceps, leg biceps, spinal erectors, upper lats, lats, rhomboids, teres minor, and teres major. So those muscles are pretty hard to overdevelop. Now, let's move on to tip number four. All right, so tip number four. I don't know what tip I'm on, but anyways, develop a balance between your uppers and lowers. Now, what does that mean? I'm talking about the relationship between the upper and lower pecs, upper and lower thighs, upper and lower biceps and triceps. One should never overpower the other, but more emphasis should be placed on the upper pecs, the lower biceps, the triceps, and thighs. This improves balance and shape. So I'm gonna let you in on a little secret. Now, Larry Scott, if you've ever seen him, he has that famous pose where he has the left forearm on the hip and he has the right arm sticking out, where the picture really emphasizes his right forearm and his lower bicep. Now, let me tell you where he got that pose from. He got it from the Paperboy. The Paperboy inspired that pose. When Larry Scott, I don't know how the story went down, but Larry Scott said that the Paperboy handed him the paper, and he was like, Larry Scott was so impressed by this guy's lower bicep, he decided to create that pose just from that Paperboy. So that's where that pose came from. But anyways, the reason. So I mean, Larry Scott, it was an impressive muscle. So he thought, oh, that's so impressive. Like I should really develop that lower part of my bicep. Now, what do you think the preacher curl works? It works the lower bicep pretty good. Now, there's a reason why Larry Scott would want to really develop the lower part of his bicep, because, like I said earlier, this improves balance and shape. All right, so now we're on the last tip. Last tip is emphasize the origins and insertions of the muscles when you train, not just the central belly of the muscle. Basic exercises tend to develop just the belly of a muscle. This is important for building mass, but too much mass in the belly gives the muscle a shortened, bunched up look. If you want nicer shape, use like isolation exercises to develop the origins and insertions. All right, so we talked about what symmetry is. I gave you some good examples of people that have good symmetry. Frank Zane, Steve Reeves, Francis Benefato. I talked about what can happen if you don't have the right shape and symmetry. And then I talked about how to achieve symmetry. Gave you some really good tips, some really valuable tips. All right, so now you have the blueprint on how to achieve symmetry. Honestly, it's just kind of frustrating to like see people struggle with this issue. Like they don't know anything about bodybuilding. They don't know about that you should the lower bicep is worked by the preacher curl, and you should develop this muscle to an extent because it helps with your size and symmetry. You should work the upper pecs more than do squats because it builds a lot of the upper thighs. It just frustrates me. Like when I tell people I don't do squats or deadlift, like I do squats so sometimes, but there's a reason why I don't really do a lot of those exercises because they work the hips and glutes. Like people think I just do this to like fuck around with people, or like I'm serious about helping people like achieve a symmetrical, proportional, classic physique. That's what I'm really interested in. I'm in favor. I want to be the giant. I want to be in service of you. I want to help you out. This is exactly why I make all these videos, because it's like it's so damn frustrating to like be lost and no one to help you. Like I guarantee you, there's no one on YouTube that is making videos like I am. Like I'm making everything old school. Like all the tips I'm giving you, all old school shit. Anyways, rant over. Subscribe if you want to see more videos like this. Like this video right now if you think it's gonna help you out or it did help you out. With that being said, thanks for watching. This is Old School Dan checking out. Peace.